Triumph of the City is a 2011 work by the Harvard economist Edward Glaeser. Glaeser argues that cities are the principal physical sites in which humankind flourishes, and that we need more and bigger cities. Rural and suburban living should be discouraged. That might strike some people as counterintuitive, but his arguments are persuasive. First, the definition. Cities are the absence of physical space between people and companies, he tells us. They are proximity, denseness, closeness, for which modern communications technology is no substitute. Denseness is best achieved by building upwards. So the successful city is largely premised on skyscrapers. The opposite of building upwards is urban sprawl, which Glaeser firmly opposes. There are three prerequisites for a successful city: safe streets, that is a low crime rate, short commutes and good schools. The fully fledged successful city is characterised by a high intensity sharing of ideas and by significant cultural and technological innovation. Successful cities are society's economic motors. Contrary to popular myth, Glaeser says, the inhabitants of successful cities are also happier than the average citizen, because population denseness leads to richer and more varied leisure opportunities. Niche entertainments stand a much greater chance of success if they have millions of potential customers within walking distance. Equally mythical, he thinks, is the idea that cities create poverty. They don't. They attract poor people. People desperate to escape the poverty of the countryside. The fact that a city attracts poor people means it's successful. Otherwise, why would they come? Perhaps the most important reason for valuing cities, he says, is that city dwelling is significantly greener than suburban and rural living. Suburbanites rely heavily on their cars in a way in which urban dwellers don't, so their carbon footprint is usually much deeper. And that's why urban sprawl is so bad. There are, of course, problems with Glaeser's thesis, or at least his presentation of it in Triumph of the City, but I don't think they're insurmountable. Firstly, the strong political administration that Glaeser requires as the successful city's prerequisite isn't inevitable, and when it does appear, it probably won't stop at law enforcement, transport and education. If the electorate demands tighter building restrictions, it'll probably have to grant those as well. And are safe streets, short commutes and good schools a necessary or a sufficient condition of a successful city? Glaeser devotes a lot of space to Detroit as a failed or at least failing city. But if the mayor of Detroit was to install those things, would that turn the city around? I don't mean could it, I mean would it? The second problem is Glaeser's condemnation of NIMBYism. He points out that people need living space and that's got to be provided somewhere. NIMBYs simply shift the problem, which is of course true. But if urban sprawl is undesirable, then NIMBYs in the countryside and the suburbs might not be a bad thing. Yes, the building has to go somewhere, but why not in Glaeser's preferred site, upwards in the city centre? NIMBYs in the suburbs might compel a removal of building restrictions there, especially if they've read Triumph of the City and they can point out how that will benefit everyone. True, there might also be NIMBYs in the city centre, but Glaeser points out that a lot of city dwellers don't own their homes. More accommodation might therefore work to their advantage. Homeowners naturally deplore decreasing property values, renters not so much. The final problem, and it is quite a big one, is that Glaeser doesn't really take the tourist industry into account. All the different zoning restrictions on new development in his native New York City strike him as irrational and harmful. In order to properly assess the accuracy of that assessment, however, he needs to ask how much revenue tourism brings to New York City and the extent to which that consideration drives the restrictions, which he doesn't. They might not be as irrational as he imagines. Having said all that, this book is over a decade old now. It continues to be an important read.